Hello, this is Dr. Brown, and in this video, I'm going to go over some of the concepts you need to understand in test one. We're going to talk about polynomial functions and also rational functions and their concepts. We're going to first, before working any problems, talk about some general things about a polynomial function. I know you've seen y equal f of x, where n is the order of the polynomial, which is the largest exponent of n. And we're generally going to be talking about zeros, so we're going to be looking at the values of x, which make polynomial zero. Also, I want to note that a sub n through a sub zero are real coefficients. In that case, there will be n zeros. They could be of various types. They could be all real. They could be all complex or mixed. If a zero is complex, if x equals a plus bi is a zero, we can be sure that a minus bi is also zero. Don't get this backwards and say minus a plus bi is a zero. That will not be true. You need to take the complex. Those can be of various multiplicities. For instance, we could have x minus 3 to the fourth power, x minus 7 to the fifth power, and x equals 3 would be a zero with multiplicity 4, and x equals 7 has multiplicity 5. The one with multiplicity 4, which is even, would just touch the x-axis. And the one, x equals 7 with multiplicity 5, which is odd, will cross the x-axis. Now, as x approaches infinity in a polynomial, term a sub n x to the n, in other words, a term in which x has the largest exponent, it will dominate. So let's suppose that n is even. Then as x goes to infinity, no matter what it does in the middle, it'll be up at the right and up at the left. If A is positive, and it will be down at the left and down at the right if A is negative. if it's an odd exponent, and it'll be down at the left, and up at the right, or up at the left, and down at the right. So you can clearly see if it's an odd polynomial, then it has to have at least one real zero. Because if you start down here and end up here, or start up here and end down here, you've got to cross the x-axis. But a polynomial with this even doesn't necessarily have to have any real zeros. They could all be above the x-axis or below the x-axis and never cross. We're also going to be talking about rational functions where y is equal to r of x is p of x over q of x, where p is a polynomial function of degree n, and q is a polynomial function of degree m. Now, we're going to be graphing these, and we will find out that depending on the nature of the rational function, that we could have what we call asymptotes. First, x asymptote. Next asymptote is when q of x equals zero at, say, x equals x naught. So it has a factor x minus x naught. So x equal x naught would be a vertical asymptote if x minus x naught is not factor in the denominator. Then we're going to have maybe y asymptotes. If n is more than m, let me clear this up right there. If n is more than m, then the denominator is overcome by the numerator, and there is no y asymptote. Y approaches infinity. If n is less than m, then q of x dominates, that's the denominator dominates, and y equals zero is the y asymptote. Now, if n equals m, then r of x equal y approaches a sub n x to the n over, since n is equal to m, it'll be b sub n x to the n. So it approaches A sub n over B sub n. And that is the y asymptote. Now, if n is equal to m plus 1, in other words, just one more degree than the denominator, then you have an oblique asymptote, which we talked about in the videos, and we'll use long division. Calculate the asymptote. Now we're going to start working some problems. First one is to find the equation of the horizontal asymptote, if there is one for the function. Notice that as x approaches infinity, h of x equal y equals 2x squared over 3x squared equal 2/3. So the horizontal asymptote is equal to y equal 2/3. Now we just want to state whether or not y equal f of x x times x minus 12 is a polynomial function. It can be expanded to be x squared minus 12x. All the exponents are either 0 or positive. And so, yes, it is, and the degree is 2. So the answer is A. Now, here we want to state whether or not function is a polynomial function, and here we would rewrite it as 2 minus x to the minus 3. Notice that this exponent is negative, and so it is not a polynomial. So the answer is D. Number 4, we want to, for this polynomial list, each real zero in its multiplicity, and whether or not the graph crosses or touches the x-axis. First of all, we'll look at the first factor. And because x squared plus 1 would have to equal to 0, then x squared is equal to minus 1. So x is equal to plus or minus I, which is imaginary. So this is not a real zero, but the other one, x plus 4 squared equals 0, means that x equals minus 4 is a zero, which is real, and it is multiplicity 2, and it means that it just touches. So in that case, it's answer D. Just touches the x-axis. We have another one very similar. X squared plus 1 does not have a real 0, but here we have x equal 2 is a real 0, multiplicity 2, so it just touches. So the answer D. I'm sorry. Just touches, just as I wrote, but the answer is A. Multiplicity 2 touches the x-axis. Now we want to find a polynomial whose zeros and degrees are given. zeros, minus 2, multiplicity 2, 2, multiplicity 1, so the degree is 3. So now we would write, factor would be x plus 2, because minus 2 is a 0. Since it's multiplicity 2, we would get x plus 2 squared. And then the x equals 2, 0, we have a factor x minus 2, multiplicity 1. So now we need to multiply this out. And let's just write it this way, x plus 2 times x plus 2 times x minus 2. And I'm going to multiply the x plus 2 times the x minus 2 first, because the cross terms would zero out. So we get x squared minus 4 times x plus 2. Now we just FOIL this out, and we get x cubed plus 2x squared minus 4x minus 8 is the polynomial, and that would be answer D. Number 7. We want to do the same thing. We see that x equals 1/2 is 0, and it's it just touches. And at x equals 4, 0, and it just touches. In order to see where the graph is above and below the x-axis, the best thing to do is to graph it. So we're going to call on our calculator, and we're going to clear it and put in x minus, since it's 1/2, I'll just put 0.5 to the 4th power. And then x minus 4 to the 5th power. By the way, notice I said at x equals 4, it just touches. It's going to go through because it's odd. We're going to graph this. Between, let's go, let's zoom to the standard window. Start off with zoom 6. And you'll see 0 is at x equals 1/2. Between minus infinity and 1/2, it's below the axis. And it's also below the axis between 1/2 and 4. And above 4 is above the axis. So the answer to this is above the axis from 4 to infinity, below the axis from minus infinity to 1/2, and from 1/2 to 4. And let's correct this. At x equals 4, it crosses the axis. Now, number eight, we want to find the x and y intercepts of f. Let's factor this, f of x equal x times 49 minus x squared equal x times 7 minus x, 7 plus x. So the x-intercepts will be where this is 0, so that's at x equals 0, x equals 7, and x equals minus 7 are the x-intercepts. And the y-intercepts are where x equals 0, f is 0, is then 0 times 49 minus 0 squared, so this is 0. So the y-intercept is 0. So x-intercepts, 0, 7, and minus 7, and y-intercept of 0. Now here we want to find the vertical asymptotes of this rational function. We've already got the numerator factored, but we need to factor the denominator, which is factorable into 4x minus 7 x plus 1. Check it and make sure it equals the denominator, and sure enough it is. So the factors in the denominator are not canceled out in the numerator. So 4x minus 7 equals 0, or 4x equals 7, and x equals 7 fourths is one vertical asymptote. X plus 1 equals 0, or x equals minus 1 is the other vertical asymptote. So the answer is D, 7 fourths and minus 1. And we want to use this graph to find the vertical asymptote. This is a very clear graph. And notice that y goes to infinity as x gets closer and closer to minus 3. So x equals minus 3 is the vertical asymptote. Notice that it has horizontal asymptotes of 0. Now, number 11, we want to find the equation of the oblique asymptote. And here we need to do a long division. So we divide x plus 5 into x squared minus 5x plus 9. And we start off and divide x into x squared and get x. Multiply x times these terms and we get x squared plus 5x. Then subtract, we get minus 10x. That's minus 5x minus 5x is minus 10x. Bring down your 9, and then x goes into minus 10x minus 10. Multiply, we get minus 10x minus 50. And then we subtract and get 9 minus minus 59. That last one is 50. So it'd be 9 minus minus 50, which is 59. The remainder doesn't matter here. What matters is the term up here. And so the oblique asymptote is y equals x minus 10. So that's answer A. Now we want to graph this function. Obviously it's going to have vertical asymptotes at x equals plus or minus 3. And it will have zeros where x to the 4th equal 1 or x equal plus or minus 1. So it's going to be going through the x-axis at plus or minus 1. What we're going to do is graph this and so we use parentheses and put in x to the 4th. Excuse me, we need to clear this out. Put in x to the 4th minus 1 divided by x squared minus 9. And let's let the window for x be, as they have it, minus 10, plus 10. But for the y window, minus 50, plus 50. And graph. And sure enough, we get vertical asymptotes at x equal plus or minus 3. If you zoomed in here, in fact, let's do that just to illustrate. And also we have the vertical asymptotes up here, so the answer is going to be B. But I just wanted to show you, if you change the window on y from like minus 2 to plus 2, we should be able to see the x intercepts this graph. It does go through plus or minus 1. So the answer to this is B. Another one, find the equation of the horizontal asymptote. If any of this equation, as x goes to infinity, y equal r sub x approaches, the numerator approaches minus 3x squared, and the denominator approaches x squared. So this is equal to minus 3 is the horizontal asymptote. You can also check it by putting this in your calculator. Now, number 14, we want to find the y-intercept of this function. That means we just put in x equals 0 and get f of 0 is equal to 0 cubed minus 6 over 0 squared plus 3 equals minus 2. So the y-intercept is 0 and minus 2, which is answer A. Now, here's an application of graphing when you graph what is called a Laffer curve that economists use to predict the government revenue from tax rates from 0 to 100%. Well, if you take 100% of someone's income, they're not going to want to make much money. If you take, and you won't get any revenue, if you take 0%, no matter what they make, then you're not going to get anything. So there's some rate in between. Some economists believe that will give you the most return. So the example here is r of x equals 10x times 100 minus x to divided by 75 plus x. We're going to graph this on our calculator. Clear it out, and we're going to put x times 100 minus x divided by, got to use parentheses, 75 plus x, and we're going to go on the x window from 0 to 100. And the revenue's in millions, so let's go from 0. Looks like the answers are going to be below 300 million, so let's put 300 million at the top and see if we capture the full curve when we graph it. Sure enough, we do, and we see a maximum value here. And if we put our trace on and move the cursor to the left of the max, and we calculate second calc, say we want to calculate the maximum, it asks us what the left bound is. Well, we have it on the left, so we hit enter. And right bound, we will move it over, hit enter, and for a guess, don't hit enter, just hit enter. I mean, don't take a guess, just hit enter, and you find the maximum is 39.56%, run it off to 39.6%, and the revenue is 208.7 million, round it off to the nearest million. 209 million. So we see the answer is A. Now, number 16, we want to solve the inequality. It's a function of A. Well, we're going to put this in the calculator and see where the graph is above zero. But since we will pick the variable of the x instead of a. So let's put in x plus 7 x minus 5 and x minus 7 and all the zeros are between minus 10 and plus 10. I'm going to zoom to the standard window. We want to see where this is above the x-axis. And you can see between minus 7 and 5, it's above the x-axis. And it's above between 7 and infinity. And it's below the x-axis between 5 and 7. So the answer is A. It's above the x-axis, or between minus 7 and 5, or 7 to infinity. Now, number 17 says we want to use a rational zero theorem. find the real zeros of the polynomial. But what we're going to do is not use a rational zero theorem. We're going to use our calculator to find the real zeros. And then the factor that produce those real zeros will be divided into the overall polynomial to get the remaining factor. So let's calculate those zeros. Put in 4x to the 4th minus 7x cubed plus 11. Okay, you got to be careful here, folks. Make sure you bring the exponent down. 4x to the 4th, you need to push forward, minus 7x cubed. Don't get to going too fast or you will put the wrong thing in. 11x squared minus 14x plus 6. And we're going to zoom to the standard window. And notice we see two zeros. And I'm going to expand this a little bit, make the window between 0 and, say, 2. And let y go from minus 4 to plus 4. Graph it so we get a better idea of a 0. Obviously, this 0 is 1. But this zero we want to get, let's actually zoom in just a little bit more. Go maybe minus 1, plus 1, and see it even better. Graph it. Now you see the zero at one and the other one looks like it's, if you just guessed, you might say 0.7, 0.8. But what we need to do is find out exactly what it is and go second trace. And we want to find the zero, hit two. We have a left bound, so we hit enter. For the right bound, we'll move it over to the right, hit enter, and then hit enter one more time. And it tells us the zero is 0.75, which is 3/4. And y equal also 0 at x equal 1. So the zeros are x equal 3/4. And x equal 1. Then we write down the factors. That will be x minus 3/4 times x minus 1. And some reason, I'm going to keep on going here. It wants to add a little extraneous things from my pen. So x minus 3/4 times x minus 1. Notice the first term is 4x to the fourth. So to make that come out, we need to multiply by 4. And so we get a factor 4x minus 3 times x minus 1 equals 4x squared minus 7x plus 3. And now we will do a long division of 4x squared minus 7x plus 3. Divided into 4x to the 4th minus 7x cubed plus 11x squared minus 14x plus 6. And now we're going to do a long division. 4x squared goes into 4x to the 4th. X squared times, multiply, and we get 4x to the 4th minus 7x cubed plus 3x squared. Subtract, and we get 0, 0. 11x squared minus 3x squared is 8x squared. Bring down to minus 14x plus 6. 4x squared goes into 8x squared 2 times. Multiplying, we get 8x squared minus 14x plus 6. Subtracting, we get 0, remainder of 0, which is what we would expect because we knew this is a factor, and the other factor is x squared plus 2. So now the zeros are 1 and 3 quarter. Factors x minus 1 times 4x minus 3 times x squared plus 2. Problem 18. We're going to not use a rational zeros theorem, but we're going to use our calculator to find the real zeros. This polynomial function and then factor it over the real numbers. I'm going to ask you to put this in your calculator, pause the video now and put it in your calculator to reassure yourself that what the zero is. So pause it and then come back. The zero is x equal 4, and it touches the x-axis. So the question is it multiplicity 2 or multiplicity 4? If it's 2, it would be x minus 4 squared. If it's multiplicity 4, it'll be x minus 4 to the 4th power, which would be x to the 4th plus terms in the middle plus minus 4 to the 4th power, which is 256. Well, that is not equal to 16, so we can rule out x minus 4 to the 4th power, but we do know that x minus 4 squared would be the factor, and that's x squared minus 8x plus 16. So to find the remaining term, we need to do long division. And divide it into 5x to the 4th minus 40x cubed plus 81x squared minus 8x plus 16, x squared goes into 5x to the fourth 5x squared times. Multiply out, we get 5x to the fourth minus 40x cubed plus 80x squared. Subtracting, we get 0, 0, 81x squared minus 80x squared is x squared. Bring down to minus 8x plus 16. And we get x squared goes into x squared one time. And so we see that everything subtracts out, the remainder is 0. And so the factor are x minus 4 squared times 5x squared plus 1. The 0 is 4 with multiplicity 2, so the answer is 8. Number 19 is to find the intercepts of this function. That's pretty simple. The x-intercepts are x equals minus 6, x equals 5, and x equals minus 5. And the y-intercept, put x equals 0 in, get f of 0 equals 0 plus 6, 0 minus 5, 0 plus 5 equals minus 150. So the y-intercept is minus 150, and the x-intercepts are minus 6, minus 5, and 5, so it's answer A. Now number 20, we want to solve this in the real number system. Let's go ahead and put this in our calculator. We're going to bring up the calculator and put 2x to the fourth minus 2x cubed plus x squared minus 5x minus 10. And let's zoom to the standard window. And let us see if we put this in right. 2x to the fourth minus 2x cubed. Okay, number 20, we're going to cut this before. Number 20, we need to solve the equation in the real number system. We're going to clear it, get 2x the fourth power minus 2x cubed plus x squared times 5x minus 10. And let's zoom to the standard window. And we see a zero at x equal minus 1 and x equal plus 2. And the answer would be x equal minus 1, x equal plus 2. So the set would be minus 1 and 2, which is answer A. Now, number 21, information is given about a polynomial. Its degree is 6. It's got zeros, 2 and 0, 2 plus I, and minus 4 minus I. So it's got two more zeros. Two of them are already complex conjugates. So that because they come in pairs, 2 minus I would be a factor, as would minus 4 plus I. So that is answer A. Just be sure and don't reverse the real part and say minus 2 plus I or 4 minus I. It's going to be the complex conjugate. So if 2 plus I is a 0, 2 minus I is, if minus 4 minus I is a 0, minus 4 plus I is. Number 22, find a polynomial with real coefficients having the given degrees and zeros. We got a degree 4. Zero is minus 1 and 2, so we know a factor would be x plus 1 and x minus 2. And then 1 minus 2i is a 0, so also 1 plus 2i is the other 0, so that makes up the 4. So now the factor for 1 minus 2i would be x minus 1 plus 2i and x minus 1 minus 2i. Let me make that a little clearer here. X minus 1 minus 2i. And now we have to multiply all this out. So the first two terms would be x squared minus x minus 2. And now we need to multiply the one with the complex zeros. We're going to treat x minus 1 as a first. And x minus 1 times x minus 1 is x squared minus 2x plus 1. Notice that the outside is minus 2i times x minus 1. The inside is 2i times x minus 1, so they cancel out exactly. And the last term is minus 4i squared. I squared is minus 1. So we're going to have x squared minus x minus 2 times x squared minus 2x plus 1. This is going to be plus 4, so it's going to be plus 5. And now we need to multiply this term times this term. So we'll start with the x squared and get x to the 4th. Minus 2x cubed. Plus 5x squared. Then we're going to multiply the minus x times everything. And we'll get minus x cubed minus x times minus 2x is going to be plus 2x squared. The minus x times a 5 is going to be minus 5x. And then finally, the minus 2 times everything is going to give you minus 2x squared plus 4x minus 10. And now we need to collect all like terms, and we get x to the 4 minus 2x cubed minus x cubed. It's minus 3x cubed. Then we have 5x squared, 2x squared, minus 2x squared, is plus 5x squared. And then we get minus 5x plus 4x is minus x. And then finally, the constant is minus 10. So f of x, the polynomial, is given by this term, and that is answer D. Number 23, we want to find the zeros of the function, right? It has a product of linear factors. And in this case, I'm going to ask you to stop and put this in your calculator. When you do, you'll find out that the real zeros are x equal minus 3, x equal minus 2. There are no other zeros, so the other two have to be complex conjugates. So the factor would be x plus 3, x plus 2, x squared plus 5x plus 6, and we need to divide that into the overall polynomial x to the 4th plus 5x cubed plus 15x squared plus 45x plus 54. X squared into x squared goes x fourth goes x squared times. We get x to the fourth plus 5x cubed plus 6x squared. Subtract, we get 0. By the way, this is 5, 0, 15x squared minus 6x squared is 9x squared. Bring down to 45x plus 54. X squared goes into 9x squared 9 times. We get 9x squared plus 45x plus 54. And the remainder is 0, as we would expect if you did it correctly. So the other factor is x squared plus 9 equals 0, so x squared is equal to minus 9, x equal plus or minus 3i. So the other two factors are x minus 3i and x plus 3i. And so the answer is the x plus 3 times the x plus 2 times the two imaginary zeros factors. Number 24, want to find all the zeros of the function, write it as a product of linear factors. I'm going to ask you to pause and put this in your calculator, and you will find that x equal plus 1 is the only real zero. So we need to divide x minus 1, the factor, into x cubed minus x squared plus 4x minus 4. X into x cubed goes x squared times. We get x cubed minus x squared. Subtract, and we get 4x minus 4. So x into 4x, bring down, bring down the 4x minus 4. We get x goes into 4x 4 times. 4x minus 4, remainder 0. So the other factor is x squared plus 4, and that means that x squared plus 4 equals 0. 0, x squared is equal to minus 4, x equals plus or minus 2i. So the answer to this is x minus 1, the factor that produces the real 0, and then x plus 2i. X minus 2i. We want to use a given zero to find the remaining zeros. Notice we're given that the zero is minus 3. If you put it in your calculator, you would see that it is the zero, the only real zero, crosses one time, and that therefore, the factor would be x plus 3. We divide that into x cubed minus 3x squared minus 5x plus 39. Now we, x into x cubed is x squared, x cubed plus 3x squared, subtract, and we get minus 6x squared minus 5x. Divide the x into the minus 6x squared, and we get minus 6x. Multiply, and we get minus 6x squared minus 18x. Subtract, and we get 0 here. Minus 5x minus minus 18x is 13x. Bring down the 39. X goes into 13x 13 times. We get 13x plus 3 times 13 is 39. Remainder is 0. And so this is the other factor, and it's got to have complex zeros. And to do that, we're going to use the quadratic formula. Remember, a is 1, b is minus 6, c is 13. So x is minus b, which is minus minus 6, which is 6, plus or minus the square root of b squared, which is 36. Minus 4 times A, which is 1, times C, which is 13, divided by 2, 6, plus or minus the square root of 36, minus 52, over 2, equals 6, plus or minus the square root of minus 16, all divided by 2, which is 6, plus or minus 4i over 2 equals 3, plus or minus 2i. So now we see that the other two zeros, answer B, 3 plus 2i, 3 minus 2i. So this is where you need to remember the quadratic formula to find the zeros of the quadratic. Now, you want to find all the zeros of the function and write it as a product of linear factors. This is another one. Why don't you try to do it yourself and at least put this in your calculator. You'll find that the real zero is x equal 2. It's the only real zero. The other two have to be complex. So x minus 2 is a factor. And we need to divide that into x cubed plus 4x squared minus 2x minus 20. X in the x cubed is x squared. X cubed minus 2x squared, subtract, and we get 6x squared, bring down to minus 2x, x goes into 6x squared, 6x times, we get 6x squared minus 12x, subtract, and you get minus 2x minus minus 12x is 10x. Bring down your minus 20. X goes in to 10x 10 times. We get 10x minus 20. We must have done it right because we get a remainder 0. If you don't, then something went wrong in your long division. So the other factor is x squared plus 6x plus 10. So A is equal to 1, B is equal to 6, C is equal to 10, X equal minus B plus or minus the square root of B squared minus 4AC all over 2A. You get X equal minus 6 plus or minus the square root of 36. Minus 4 times 1 times C, which is 10, all over 2. So we get minus 6 plus or minus the square root of 36. Minus 40 all over 2 equals minus 6 plus or minus the square root of minus 4 over 2, which is minus 6 plus or minus 2i. Over 2, which is minus 3 plus or minus 2i. So now, to get the factors, we already know a factor is x minus 2, but the other factor would be x plus 3. Excuse me. 2 into 2i is I. I'm not going to go back and do this one. 2 into 2i is I, so the zeros are minus 3 plus or minus I, so the factor would be x plus 3 minus I, x plus 3 plus I. And that is answer C. Problem 27, and the last one is an easy one. We got degree 5, zeros 2i and 2i. Since it's got two imaginary zeros, these zeros are 0 plus I, of course, and 0 plus 2i. So we have to have the conjugates 0 minus i and 0 minus 2i. So the two remaining zeros are minus I and minus 2I, which is answer D.